is just busting all the cultural paradigms here. He goes right to the woman and he talks to her. But what he's telling her is, you know, what you will find out is the most important thing is a time is coming and has now come when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. So the critical element of the kingdom of God within us, it's imperative that we embrace this same fact, that we need to worship God in the spirit, but we also need to worship him in truth, that we got to have a balance. And the thing that Jesus said in John 14:26, which reinforces what we talked about last week, but the counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you everything I have said to you. You see, the Holy Spirit makes God's word come alive to us. But the question is, what are the scriptures? What is this thing called the Bible? 2 Timothy 3:16, the Apostle Paul says, all scripture, the Bible, is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That one verse is known by most evangelical Christians. They've got it memorized. And that scripture really does talk about that all of scripture was breathed by God into man and inspired man to write down God's word and his truth. And so from Genesis all the way to Revelation, it is God's word that was inspired to man, to us. So it is God's word that is spoken to us. He spoke through the prophets. He spoke through the fathers of the faith. He spoke through the epistle writers. He spoke through those that wrote the Gospels and recorded Jesus' acts and his ministry and his teachings. But many people ask, you know, there's 66 books in the whole Bible, the Old Testament to the New Testament, written by over 40 authors, and it was written over a span of 1,500 years. And many people surmise, how in the world can that be God's word? It's very interesting. We started reading this book in our small group. It's a profound book. It's called The Miracle of the Scarlet Thread by Richard Booker. In this book, what he talks about is God's covenant with man is weaved throughout the whole scriptures from Genesis all the way to Revelation. And when you see how this scarlet thread is interweaved through every book of the Bible, and you see that every book of the Bible is giving us a picture of the covenant that God has made with us to send us Jesus Christ the Messiah, it's unbelievable to see how it all perfectly fits together. When I read, the more I read of the Bible, the more I'm in awe of, oh my goodness, look at what God has done. Now, of course, there are volumes of books that are written that are arguments of why this is God's word, and I don't have time to spell it out. But the question is, what do the scriptures do for us? Why should I read the Bible? There's a number of reasons, and I'm going to cover a few. And there's more than this. But first and foremost, is the scriptures lead us to Jesus and to salvation. John 20:31 says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. It's very intriguing that as I've talked to people, I was talking with Bob Clifford just Thursday. He said that reading about the prophecies and seeing how those prophecies were fulfilled, it led him to believe that God was real. How have the scriptures led you to Jesus? I saw this movie a couple weeks ago, and when I saw this scene, I go, oh, I got to use this scene for for this message. Because in this scene, he talks about how reading a book helps this young boy to learn about this man, Lord Nelson. Let's look at the screen.
Lord Blakeney. Feeling better?
Much better, thanks, sir.
Well, good. Good. The doctor told me you were fond of reading, so I... It has all of his major battles in it and some very fine illustrations.
Thank you, sir. Did you ever meet Lord Nelson, sir?
I had the honor and privilege of serving with him at the Nile, a great victory. You can find it in here, actually. Page 135, if I'm not mistaken. Yes.
May I beg you to tell me what kind of man he is?
You should read the book.
I will, sir. Thank you.
That was so perfect. Can you tell me what kind of man he was? And he says, you should read the book. You know what I have seen in the years that I've been a pastor and in the years that I was attending church myself is many of us are dependent on what is taught from the pulpit once a week to give them a glimpse of Jesus. But the reality is that's like eating one meal a week. You'll end up really skinny and frail if that's all you do. The way that we get the nutrition in our bodies is by having daily meals, right? The same thing with the scriptures is the only way we can all get to know Jesus is we all got to read the book. And in reading the book, the Father reveals Jesus to us. And the more you know him, the more you love him, and the more you become like him. And that's really what a disciple is. The scriptures also show us how to live and manage our lives. I love this passage from Deuteronomy 11, verse 8. It says, "Observe therefore all the commands I'm giving you today." This is Moses talking to the people. "So that you may have the strength to go in and take over the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, and so that you may live long in the land that the Lord swore to your forefathers to give them and their descendants, a land flowing with milk and honey." Listen to this. "So if you faithfully obey the commands I am giving you today," so there's the formula there, if you do this, "to love the Lord your God and serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, then I will send rain on your land in its season, both autumn and spring rains, so that you may gather in your grain, your wine, and oil." What a great promise that God gives us when we absorb his truths and live it. Now, hear me out. This is really important. I need to say this because this is critical, man. Nudge your neighbor if they're sleeping, say, "Wake up, dude, you got to hear this." Okay? This is so important. If you leave here and you miss this, I have failed miserably. But here's the deal. Following God's teachings and commands does not get you into heaven. What I mean by that is we cannot become good enough Christians that we're good enough for God to get into heaven. Because we all fail. We all have sin in our life. We all even, Scripture says, if you even not do one commandment, you have sinned. Okay? Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." So We don't read the scriptures and we don't do what the scripture says to make ourselves presentable to God. Through faith, by what God did for us on the cross, we are perfectly and wholly presentable to God through faith in the work he did for us. You get that? And so if you have never confessed your sins to Christ and asked for forgiveness of your sins, that's how we become presentable to God. And I give you the invitation to do that even right now. Just say, God, forgive me. I have lived my life without you. God, fill me with your spirit and help me to live as this little oriental guy is talking about. And so why do we read the Bible? And why do we do what the Bible says? He says that if you do these things, your life is going to go well. Because God created us to live this way. And when we do things the way God prescribes us to do it, all of a sudden you start seeing God's favor, you see his blessings, and you see that it works. It works in relationships, it works in our finances, it works in our hearts, it even works physically in us. It changes us. You ever been to Home Depot? I know there's those you guys out there, you go in the Home Depot and you go in the tool section and you just start drooling. They got all these tools hanging up there. I don't even know what most of those tools are. But the reason there's so many different tools, there's even one kind of tool I was looking for and there were 10 sizes of it. I didn't know which one to get. But the reason there's so many different tools is they all have a specific purpose. And when you use it for that specific purpose, your job is done right. Here I am, I'm using a screwdriver to try to chisel off some wood, and I'm using a little wrench and where a socket set would do it much quicker and much more efficiently because I just don't have the tools. I call guys who do. But that's why the scriptures tell us if you live life the way God prescribes it, you will begin to see things changing in your life for the better. It's not to make us better in God's eyes, but it's to live out our life where God's blessings can be poured out on us. And when we live life the way God prescribes it, he's just saying, now you got it, bro. Let me give you the things I've been waiting to give you, but you have to do it the way I prescribe it. Does that make sense? Man, when I began to understand this, it changed something within me that I said, you know, when I read something in the Word, I just got to start doing it. Because I trust in God that he's going to make his Word come true in my life. So another thing that God's Word does is it keeps us from sin. Because sin messes up everything. Psalm 119:11 says, I have hidden your word in my heart so that I might not sin against you. And what it's talking about here is we all have weaknesses within our hearts. All of us do. It's just it may be different for all of us. One of the areas that I know a lot of men struggle with is the area of lust and sexual temptations. And you know, when I began, when Jane and I were early in our marriage, when I began to take God's word seriously, I began to take to heart the warnings that I began to read about sexual kind of sins. Proverbs 5, 3 through 5, just as one of the many warnings in the book of Proverbs in this area. It says, for the lips of an adulteress drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter gall, bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lead straight to the grave. And so as I began to read these proverbial truths and I began to understand the warnings that God was giving me with them, I asked for God to give me the strength to keep my eyes not focused on the things that I shouldn't be focused on, and to keep my heart devoted to Jane and only to Jane, and to keep me from getting in relationships in an inappropriate way. And this June, Jane and I will be at 24 years together. She is a saint to put up with me that long. But God's word and his warnings, you know, it's the one thing is I'm just too chicken. When I see the things that it says, the warnings of where it leads, it's like, I just don't want to go there. I hate pain. Why bring more of it on my life? You know, it's really true. I believe God's word, and I know that's what happens because I've seen it in too many people, and it breaks my heart. The next thing is God's word is it's food for our soul. The promises of God brings incredible grace to our hearts at those moments that we need it. Jeremiah 15:16 says, "When your words came, I ate them. They were my joy and my heart's delight, for I bear your name, O Lord God Almighty." I know that many of us, we've faced those junctions in life where you're crying out to God, "Oh God, oh God, I need you now." And you're drawn to read the scriptures, and a promise of God leaps off the page into your heart, and the Spirit of God brings comfort where you need comfort in a way that only his word and his truth can do for us. Jane and I just returned from a quick trip to Denver to go to one of my good friend's mom's funeral. And Phyllis had four boys, and Paul, the second son, was one of my best friends. And they all got up and they shared about the incredible attributes of their mom. And the youngest son, John, gets up and he reads from Proverbs 31:27-28. And it says, "She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed." And John says, "We are calling our mother blessed because she lived this out in her life." And the thing that John was saying was this scripture, this word of God, gave all of them comfort to be thankful of the incredible life that Phyllis had and the life that she poured into her boys and how she prayed for her boys. And so they have been able to have the grace to welcome and accept their mother's death, even though it's very painful to them, but they're not bitter and they're not angry at God because they have hope in the Word of God and his promises. It was a great funeral. I'm going to have the worship team come up. So the question I have is are you at a point in your life where you need something from God? God, you've got to speak to me. God, you've got to give me some assurance that you are here. Friends, you got to go to the Bible. You yourself personally need to daily go to the Word of God and ask the Holy Spirit to fill you and to reveal his truth to you and begin to transform you from the inside out. So we're called, all of us, to set our course on this sacred journey to become students of the Word of God and to ask that the Holy Spirit bring revelation to us. And as God promises, when we become committed to a steady diet of God's Word and his Scripture, is God speaks to us. He fills our hearts. He fills us with life. And then when we take it to the next level and we actually ask the Holy Spirit to give us the strength